I'm not going to spend much longer. I think I'll just hand it over to Salman Sayyid, who is an author and an academic. He's based at the University of Leeds. You can see a fuller biography in the packs that you received on entry, but I'll hand it over to Salman now.
Thanks, Leah. Actually, my talk can be much briefer because I'd like to thank Britain First and Birkbeck College and Prevent. Now, you probably didn't think there'd be many instances where you'd hear a thank you to Britain First at a place, at a conference on Islamophobia. But it seems to me that this combination of events, the fact that we've moved, illustrates very well what I really wanted to talk about. That on one hand, you would simply think, if I was going to talk about Islamophobia, well, there were many talking about Muslims, and I think that's part of it. But what I'd like to suggest to you is that Islamophobia is really not about Muslims. It's about everybody, yeah? And it affects all of us. And it affects all of us, whether people are Muslims or not Muslims, because at the heart of Islamophobia is a device for hollowing out ideas of citizenship. In particular, hollowing out democracy. Now, one of the things that I wanted to make this point is this, that we are used to thinking about racism about mainly being directed at particular kinds of groups. So you have anti-Semitism, and that's directed at Jews. And if you're not Jewish, you don't have to worry about it too much. And racism is supposed to be directed mainly at people of color. And if you're not a person of color, you don't have to worry about it too much. And similarly, Islamophobia is directed at Muslims, and if you're not a Muslim, you don't have to worry about it too much. Now, this kind of thinking can lead to a response in which racism, anti-Semitism, and Islamophobia become kind of spectator sports for the majority of the people. You tut-tut when it comes on your TV and complain about it or think about it, and then you carry on. And my contention is this, that if you allow racism and anti-Semitism and Islamophobia to become the simply spectator sports, things that you have opinions about but don't do anything about, you will end up turning democracy itself into a spectator sport. Because what is at stake here is the hollowing out of citizenship. Islamophobia isn't really just about Muslims. It is really about using Muslims as a way of bringing about a creeping expansion of the state's power to regulate and discipline citizens. And I'll give you just three examples of this very, very quickly. When the various anti-terror legislation was introduced in Britain, we were told, cross our hearts and hope to die, that this would only be used against known terrorists, really hardcore people who want to go around blowing up people. And, you know, no one wants to be blown up, and it seemed like a reasonable thing to do. However, we know the experience of that legislation has been that one of the most infamous cases was when an 80-year-old man, heckling the Prime Minister at the Labour Party conference, was thrown out by the police under anti-terror legislation. We know that anti-terror legislation started off by looking after terrorists and then became something to make sure that people were emptying their bins properly. We know that anti-terror legislation is being used to basically take rights from reporters, affecting the freedom of press. All of this is directed not at Muslim reporters or Muslims with bins or Muslims who don't put their bins in properly, let alone Muslim men shouting at the Prime Minister. It becomes something that can be used for everyone. And this is what I would like to suggest to you, is that thinking about Islamophobia is something that affects all of us. It's very, very difficult to think how rights and obligations and citizenship is actually weakened and hollowed out. When it is hollowed out, people don't say things like, you know, these are upstanding members of the community, we're going to take away their rights. They say, these people, we're going to take away the rights of the muggers, the welfare scroungers, the criminals, the drug pushers, the pimps, the paedophiles. But really, through that process, who is a paedophile, who is a drug pusher, who is a pimp, all of these become much, much more looser categories. And if you don't believe this, look at the notion of radicalism that has moved around this anti-terrorism legislation. We started off by looking at only terrorists, suspected terrorists. And then it became basically extremists, violent extremists in the first instance. Now it's extremists. And then it's radicals. And eventually it'll be moderates who are too moderate. And then finally, timid. There's no one left, yeah? Except maybe Peter Clark. And everyone else will be suspect. So I think one of the things that I would like to say to you is this. Look at what's happening right in front of our eyes in response to the torture report that's been released. And if you look at the kind of various moves that are being made, you will see how those moves are not just simply random. They're part of this lexicon which is being used now for at least 15 odd years, since the war on terror, to try and hollow out and weaken citizenship. So the first response has been, we've got into an argument about, well, the torture was justified if it produced results. So therefore, there's a debate now whether the information gained by rectally infusing food of the people was actually worth, was useful. Yeah, so it's and there's a debate whether it's useful or not, okay? So the argument being that if we could... This is the NSA, obviously. The argument being that if by waterboarding someone 183 times, by carrying out all these various acts of torture, sorry, enhanced interrogation, if they produce results that we like, it would be worth doing. Secondly, argument is this, well, why are we talking about this torture now? This is ancient history. It happened almost 5 years ago, 3 years ago. We shouldn't be talking about it. And again, every single act of racism or any act for justice, any pointing out of injustice always becomes something retrospective. Don't worry about it, it happened before. The third thing has been around the idea, well, it can't be torture because even though the exact same acts were condemned at Nuremberg and after the Second World War, those acts were carried out by Japanese and German. And if you're an American, well, you don't do those. It can't be torture by definition. This is the Dick Cheney line, by the way. Yeah. But finally, and I think the most interesting one is the one, well, these are isolated incidents, few bad apples. And every single institution which has ever been held up to account always comes back to the idea we've got a few bad apples. Now, I think we need to understand that these few bad apples are part of an orchard which is not being guarded properly. And part of this not gardening properly is what is happening to the issue of actual democracy and citizenship. Western powers are very good at lecturing the world on democracy. Everyone should be democratic. And what I'd like to suggest to you is that perhaps that we should ask them to practice democracy, not so much abroad, but at home. And in a way, what I would say to you is this. What Islamophobia does is actually impact upon the practice of democracy. At stake is the right and the ability of, in this instance, Muslims to be organizing themselves, to be able to tell their own stories, to have their own conversations. What you are asking, if you want democracy, you have to believe in empowered communities, empowered people, who are able to try and change the conversation of the nation. Democracy cannot be just be handed down and asked to be people to read out from a script. What Islamophobia does is restrict that so that only certain people can say certain things very meekly. Now, what I'd like to suggest to you is this. If people are serious about combating radicalization, if they are serious about combating Islamophobia, these things have to be linked by deepening democracy and democratization. This is something that we should be talking about, not in terms of simply saying we want protection for Muslims or protection for other ethnic minorities. It's not so much protection, but empowerment, which is going to guarantee anything. And it's empowerment not just for Muslims, but empowerment for citizens and all citizens. And part of that empowerment is the ability to be part of the conversation in the nation and transform and be engaged in the part of being able to transform your lives. So going back to Birkbeck College and Britain First and the local authority, is it Camden or Westminster here? Camden Prevent Officer. I think what is Prevent doing is really, it appears that it's supposed to be there to prevent radicalization. But their definition of radicalization is so loose and nebulous that I would say to you what Prevent is doing is preventing democracy and democratization. And that is where I think our challenge lies, to see Islamophobia not as an issue that only affects a section of the population in this country and a section of the population on the planet. But democracy, Islamophobia affects all of our capacity to be citizens who can actually will different alternatives, different things. And I think that is a key point here. So I would like us to think about Islamophobia, not, but in general, what it's doing to the society that we live in and why it's preventing us from making the society a just place, a fairer place, where we are able to have some control over our collective destinies together.